Good evening and welcome. I'm Greg Gumbel here with my partner Clark Kellogg, bringing you the 2K Sports NCAA Selection Show. We're all set to show you the seedings and pairings, so get out your bracket sheet, get those pencils ready. Here are the basics. Of the 65 available tournament bids, 31 are automatically given to conference champions. The tournament committee hands out the remaining 34 bids on an at-large basis. An opening round game will take place on Tuesday night to narrow the field to 64 teams. Before we get into the brackets for the upcoming tournament, let's take a look at the final top 25 media poll. There's one big change you'll notice in the ranking. The Arizona Wildcats jumped all the way from the number 21 spot to number 15.
They're peaking at just the right time, Greg. This is exactly the way you want to be playing going into the tournament.
The media rankings are what everyone's been following for the last 4 months. But in just a minute, the selection committee's opinion is going to be the only one that matters. It's time to talk about the topic that has a lot of players and coaches holding their breath right now, the NCAA tournament bubble. These are the 10 teams that aren't worried as much about where they'll be playing as if they'll be playing. Clark, who jumps out at you there?
Indiana can make a case as to why they deserve a tournament bid. Problem is, everyone else can make a case as to why they don't belong in the tournament.
And we have a few more teams in similar position, right, Clark?
St. Joseph's
should be considered among the best of the major conference teams not holding an automatic bid. But there are plenty of non-power conference teams knocking on the door that may prevent them from getting an invitation.
I'm sure it's been a long week for those teams, but the wait's almost over. The NCAA selection committee has finished its meeting, and we're ready to unveil the top four seeds in this year's tournament. The Memphis Tigers are the top overall seed, and they will play in the East Regional. They begin the tournament as the dominant team in college basketball. They've been ranked number one in the media poll for the past 4 weeks. Let's see if they can live up to everyone's expectations. On to the second number one seed, who will play in the South Regional. The Michigan State Spartans are seeking their third NCAA championship in school history. The Duke Blue Devils are our third number one seed, and they'll play in the Midwest Regional. They're back in the tournament again, and no doubt they'll be feeding off the experience of last year's appearance as they try to get to the Final Four this year. And finally, our fourth number one seed will play in the West Regional. The Villanova Wildcats are in the tournament field as a number one seed for the first time in the history of their program. Now, here's how the brackets shape up based on where the number one seeds have been assigned. In one national semifinal game, the winner of the East Regional will play the winner of the South Regional. In the other semifinal game, the winner of the Midwest Regional will play the winner of the West Regional. Those games will be played on Saturday, April 4th. Then it'll be on to the national championship game on Monday night, April 6th. Anything shocking to you about those picks?
I don't think I'm alone in my surprise with these picks. Whenever you reach this far down the pole for the top seeds, you're guaranteed to have some second guesses coming your way.
So, with the number one seeds out of the way, it's finally time to tackle the rest of the brackets. First up, we take a look at the East Regional. The Memphis Tigers are the top seed, finishing at 27-1. They won both the regular season and conference tournament titles in Conference USA. They will take on the winner of the opening round play-in game between Fresno State with 14 wins and Winthrop from the Big South. And now the number 8 seed, the Chattanooga Mocs, come into the tournament first in their conference during the regular season and were winners of their conference tournament. They're going to play the number 9 seed, the St. Mary's Gales, who came in first in their conference tournament, finishing at 25-8. Cal comes in as the number 5 seed, finishing at 22-9. And they will take on the 12th seed from the Sun Belt Conference, the Golden Panthers of Florida International, with 21 wins. Miami enters the field as the number 4 seed from the ACC. This marks their 7th appearance in the NCAA tournament in school history. They'll be getting ready to face the number 13 seed, the Kansas State Wildcats. Finished the season with 20 wins.
The Miami Hurricane will be an extremely dangerous team in this tournament, mainly because they have such terrific veteran leadership. Coaches love when they have guys on the floor that have been around the block a few times because they don't get rattled. They play with composure. I look at the experience of this team as something that could put them over the top.
The Arizona State Sun Devils are in as the number 6 seed. They'll be taking on the number 11 seed, the Albany Great Danes, with 23 wins. Arizona comes in as the number 3 seed, finishing at 26-7. IUPUI comes in to face them at number 14 with 18 wins in the tournament championship of the conference. Our number 7 seed is from the ACC. The Virginia Cavaliers were rewarded for their outstanding play this season with an at-large bid and a ticket to the big dance. They are going to play the number 10 seed, the Gonzaga Bulldogs, who finished second in their conference tournament, finishing at 24-7. Next up is the number 2 seed. The North Carolina Tar Heels have established themselves as one of the best teams from the ACC. They'll be going up against the number 15 seed, Alabama A&M's Bulldogs, with 21 wins. This will be their second appearance all time in the NCAA tournament. There are going to be some incredible matchups in the later rounds of this bracket. If the top seeds can avoid the early upsets, we can look forward to some real heavyweight battles. Next up, we'll take a look at the South Regional. The Michigan State Spartans are the top seed, finishing at 29-4. They won both the regular season and conference tournament titles in the Big Ten. They'll take on the Tennessee Martin Skyhawks, the number 16-ranked team. This marks their first appearance all time in the NCAA tournament. Florida State comes in as the number 8 seed, finishing at 20-13. UNLV comes in to face them at number 9 with 23 wins and the hopes of becoming America's darling with an underdog run through the regional. Connecticut enters the field as the number 5 seed from the Big East. This will be their 29th appearance in the NCAA tournament in team history. They'll be getting ready to face the number 12 seed, the Cornell Big Red, finished the season with 19 wins.
The Connecticut Huskies have got to be among the group of teams that has a chance to win the whole thing. I love the way they play on both ends of the floor. I'd be shocked if they don't at least advance from their bracket to the Final Four. But more than that, I think they've got a legitimate shot to win some hardware.
UCLA comes in as the number 4 seed, finishing at 22-9. And they'll take on the 13th seed from the A-10 conference, the Rhode Island Rams, with 21 wins. And now the number 6 seed, the North Carolina State Wolfpack, come into the tournament 6th in their conference during the regular season and were losers in their first game at their conference tournament. They are going to play the number 11 seed, the Red Hawks of Miami of Ohio, who came in 1st in their conference tournament, finishing at 26-7. The Florida Gators are in as the number 3 seed. They'll be taking on the number 14 seed, the Nicholls State Colonels, with 18 wins. Next up is the number 7 seed. The Middle Tennessee Blue Raiders are the regular season champion from the Sun Belt Conference. They'll be going up against the number 10 seed, the Ohio State Buckeyes, with 23 wins. They return once more to the very familiar surroundings of the NCAA tournament. Our number 2 seed is from the Big 12. The Texas Longhorns had a tremendous year that included a regular season championship. They're going to play the number 15 seed, the Holy Cross Crusaders, who came in 1st in their conference tournament, finishing at 15-16. Looking into the future a little bit, this bracket looks poised for a titanic matchup in the regional final. If the top 2 seeds can take care of business in the first 3 rounds, we have the possibility of a classic Elite 8 meeting. On to our third bracket of the day. Let's take a look at the Midwest Regional. The Duke Blue Devils are the top seed, finishing at 25-7. They finished 2nd in the ACC. They'll take on the Howard Bison, the number 16-ranked team. This is their 3rd appearance in the NCAA tournament in the history of their school. Our number 8 seed is from the A-10 conference. The Xavier Musketeers had a tremendous year that included a regular season championship. They're going to play the number 9 seed, the Boston University Terriers, who finished 2nd in their conference tournament, finishing at 22-8. The Pittsburgh Panthers are in as the number 5 seed. They'll be taking on the number 12 seed, the Indiana Hoosiers, with 19 wins. Syracuse enters the field as the number 4 seed from the Big East. It's yet another appearance in the brackets for a school that's no stranger to the NCAA tournament. They'll be getting ready to face the number 13 seed, the East Tennessee State Buccaneers. Finished the season with 20 wins.
The Syracuse Orange are going to provide serious matchup problems to any team that doesn't have depth and defensive ability at both guard spots. They have outstanding backcourt play at both ends of the court. It's the main reason they've made it this far, and they're going to have to maintain that form if they want to do some damage in this tournament.
Utah comes in as the number 6 seed, finishing at 28-7. And they take on the 11th seed from the Pac-10, the Washington Huskies, with 20 wins. And now the number 3 seed, the Tennessee Volunteers, come into the tournament after finishing 2nd in their conference during the regular season and were semifinalists in their conference tournament. They are going to play the number 14 seed, the Creighton Blue Jays, who came in 1st in their conference tournament, finishing at 16-15. Next up is the number 7 seed. The West Virginia Mountaineers are the conference tournament champions from the Big East. They'll be going up against the number 10 seed, the Mustangs of Cal Poly, with 24 wins. This marks their first appearance in the NCAA tournament in team history. Stanford comes in as the number 2 seed, finishing at 27-6. Montana comes in to face them at number 15 with 16 wins in the tournament championship of the Big Sky. On the surface, I'd have to say this regional might be the most difficult of the four. Certainly the depth of quality teams here is very impressive. Whoever emerges from this bracket will have been through some battles. And finally, let's have a look at the West Regional. The Villanova Wildcats are the top seed, finishing at 25-6. They were winners of the regular season championship in the Big East. They'll take on the Ryder Bronx, the number 16-ranked team. This will be their fifth appearance ever in the NCAA tournament. Next up is the number 8 seed. The Western Michigan Broncos are the regular season champion from the MAC. They'll be going up against the number 9 seed, the Baylor Bears, with 23 wins. This will be their fifth appearance in the NCAA tournament in team history. Oklahoma State comes in as the number 5 seed, finishing at 22-7. And they will take on the 12th seed from the A-10 conference, the St. Louis Billiken, with 21 wins. Louisville comes in as the number 4 seed, finishing at 25-7. James Madison comes in to face them at number 13 with 18 wins in the tournament championship of the Colonial Athletic Association. Our number 6 seed is from the Big East. The Providence Friars were rewarded for their outstanding play this season with an at-large bid and a ticket to the Big Dance. They are going to play the number 11 seed, the Georgetown Hoyas, who were 5th in their conference, finishing at 22-11. The Clemson Tigers are in as the number 3 seed. They'll be taking on the number 14 seed, the St. Francis Red Flash, with 18 wins. And now the number 7 seed, the Wisconsin Badgers, come into the tournament as the 4th place team in their conference during the regular season and were semifinalists in their conference tournament. They are going to play the number 10 seed, the Seton Hall Pirates, who were 7th in their conference, finishing at 19-12. Alabama enters the field as the number 2 seed from the SEC. This will be their 20th appearance all time in the NCAA tournament. They'll be getting ready to face the number 15 seed, the Butler Bulldogs. Finished the season with 15 wins.
The Alabama Crimson Tide are a team that is just so powerful and strong up front. I would put their front court up against just about any other teams in the nation right now. It's always good to have strong guard play, but if you ask most coaches, I guarantee you they take the good big man over the good little man most times. Their interior play should serve them very well in this competition.
Some of the lower seeds in this bracket have the ability to not only compete with the high seeds, but win a few games. The potential for a Cinderella or two in this bracket is definitely there. What are your thoughts on our top 16 seeds, Clark?
Maybe I haven't agreed with the selection committee every year, but I think they did a great job this time. The top 16 looked just about right to me. Memphis is going to be an extremely difficult matchup for any and all of their opponents. I say all of their opponents because I think they'll have a lot of them. They're going a long way in this tournament.
Now, let's bring the conference picture into focus. The Big East gets 9 teams. The ACC with 7. 6 out of the Pac-10. The Big Ten gets 4 teams.
What a down year for the non-power conferences. We're used to seeing at least one of those conferences compete on the level of the power conferences, but not this year.
And let's not forget the teams out of the America East Conference. For a small conference, they competed at a very high level this year. Those teams could be the place to look if trying to find a Cinderella story in the tournament.
I'm surprised there were so few bids for the teams in Conference USA. It was an especially disappointing year for that conference. Usually you can count on a few of the nation's elite teams coming out of there, but this was a season where very few of those teams could maintain any type of positive momentum.
Let's come back to the bubble teams that we mentioned earlier in the show and see which of the teams were able to get into the tournament.
Georgetown had a terrific finish to the season, and I'm sure that's what put them in the field. The selection committee doesn't want teams to back into the tournament. They want teams to come in playing good basketball.
While those teams are celebrating getting into the tournament, let's take a look at the other teams who were on the short end of the stick.
Western Kentucky had a good shot in that large bid, or so I thought. But the bottom line this year was the bubble was too crowded with major conference teams, and they got stuck on the outside.
All right, Clark, now that we know all the teams and matchups, time to get the tournament underway and let the madness take over.
Greg, it's going to be a fantastic tournament. We've got an outstanding field and a lot of sensational players. I guarantee there are some memorable moments soon to come.
For my partner, Clark Kellogg, and for all of us here in the 2K Sports Studios, I'm Greg Gumbel. Thanks for joining us on the NCAA Selection Show, brought to you by State Farm, the number one auto insurer. Enjoy all the excitement of the NCAA tournament.